This is the first time I came here, but I have been speaking earlier at the other place, and so I'm very happy to see the new place. Looks good. And today the topic that we are going to speak about is a part of philosophy. When we talk about philosophy, there are different topics under which we talk about philosophy, especially when we study Western philosophy. And the topic that we are talking about is what is called epistemology. There are various other topics like ethics and metaphysics and various names like that. But the kind of thing we are going to talk about today is epistemology. Epistemology is the subject that deals with the question, what is truth? So different philosophers in the West have been talking about truth. What is truth? And here the Buddha, in that particular sutra called the Kalama Sutra, is talking about this same thing. What is truth? Because at that time, some people called the Kalamas. That word Kalama refers to a group of people. And these people came and asked a question. There are many speakers who come to our city or town or village or whatever it is and talk about their beliefs, what they consider to be truth. And in talking about truth, they always point out that what they say is the truth, and everything that other people say is not truth. So their own version of truth they speak about and condemn the version of other people's truth. So these people asked the Buddha, how do we face this problem? Because different people come and talk about different things and claim that to be the truth. Whom are we going to believe? Whom are we going to accept? So please tell us what to do. That is what people asked. So the Buddha says, it is good to doubt. You don't believe any of these things and you are doubting them. To doubt is to ask the question, is it true or is it false? That is the meaning of doubt. And he says, it is correct to doubt about doubtful matters. That's a natural thing to doubt. I don't ask you to believe any of those things. Now, today, if we examine the modern philosophy, especially the philosophy that is presented in the West, they point out that philosophy begins with doubt. So it's very important to understand that. Because from ancient times, people really begin to live in groups. All animals begin to live in groups. If you see birds, they are in a group. If you see monkeys, they will also be living with other monkeys. Even cattle, they begin to live with other cattle. So you see this tendency to live in groups is there even for the human beings. Why do people live in groups? Why do animals live in groups? Because every animal feels insecure. Every animal feels insecure. To be alone means that some other animal might come and eat this animal. So one animal becomes the food of the other animals. That is the world. So when they are in groups, at least they can run to the group and get help from the others. So when they are in a group, it is difficult to catch one animal, but then somehow they do catch one of these animals, like a lion or a tiger might come and jump into a group and get hold of one animal, and that becomes the food. It's not only lions and tigers, but even other animals who are called carnivorous animals, they are all living by eating other animals. You see, even human beings are like that. Human beings also eat other animals. It's not only animals who do that. So this is the insecurity of life. We don't know when we'll be caught. Human beings don't eat other human beings. But in ancient times, even that kind of thing had happened. Now they don't eat other human beings, but they do a different thing. That is what is called exploitation. One human being exploits other human beings. And there are different ways of exploiting even human beings. Even when you go to do a job, it's very important to see that you are being exploited. Other people may be paying you for doing the job. But that payment itself is a way of getting a job done by another person. We use it by what is called exchange. You do a job for me and I give you something for that. That's an exchange. But even in that exchange, I will be exchanging in such a way that I gain from that, and you may be losing some extent. You see, this is why some people have different salaries depending on what you do and how you do things. But still we have what are called companies. A company is also a gathering where people get together. So what all this means is there is a certain insecurity in life. This insecurity is the biggest problem. Every person who is born insecure. Now, when a small child is born, what is the first thing that the child does? The first thing most of you who are mothers or fathers know what the small infant does. The moment that infant is born, the first thing that they do is to cry. Why is that? Crying is expressing the insecurity. We start with that. Because inside the mother's womb, that infant was quite comfortable. The moment that infant comes out, it is very cold outside. Because inside was warm. It's not only cold, people begin to touch this child. And touching is also an uncomfortable thing. And then when you open your eyes, light comes up. This was not there inside the mother's womb. And that is also a very uncomfortable thing. And the most important thing, inside the mother's womb, this infant didn't breathe. Now you have to start breathing. That is also a difficult thing. So, lot of difficulty the moment you are born, the insecurity. But after some time that child begins to get used to this, and sometimes you see the child smiling. But you see, somehow as the child grows up, out of all the other animals, this human child or the infant remains helpless for a long period. Helpless, insecure. And whenever there is any problem, what does that child do? Cry, nothing else. And when the child begins to cry, the mother or the father or any older person might come and help the child. So that is how the child becomes secure. But depending on others, the older people, and if the mother or father didn't look after that infant, the infant would die. Now this child gradually begins to grow up. And gradually, this helplessness becomes a little less. But still, when it comes to, say, the age of 16, 17, 18, what happens? When the child has grown up, whenever some difficulty comes up, what does the child do? Can the child now cry and get help from the parents? Now this adult begins to realize that the father and mother are as helpless as himself or herself. Now where can they run? Whenever there is a problem, where can they run? There is no place to run. Because these people have been living in a group, that group, every group has provided a method of helping an individual. What is that? That is what is called religion. That religion has provided a powerful person. Who is that powerful person? Some might call it God, others might call it Allah. or another person might call devas, whatever the name is, they are meaning the same thing. It is some kind of supernatural being with supernatural powers. Where the natural power has disappeared, now they are going after supernatural powers. They have never seen this God, but they believe that there is a God like that. Just pray to this God and the God will help you. Even if a person asks, have you seen this God? I have not seen, but God is there. That belief itself is providing the feeling of security. This is why even with all the advancement of modern science, people have not given up the idea of believing in supernatural beings, either in the form of gods or in the form of devils. That belief is necessary just to get that feeling of security. That is why they don't want to give up that. You see, this is why some psychologists like Sigmund Freud pointed out that religion is a collective neurosis. It is a kind of mental sickness which is shared by that whole culture. That is why it is a collective neurosis. Karl Marx called it the opium of the masses, because opium is also something that people take, like alcohol, to forget about the problem completely. This is what is called an escape. Running away from the problem into a dream world. This is why Prince Siddhartha saw an old man, he saw a sick person, then he saw a dead corpse. That is how he saw the realities of life. The reality of life is that people have to face this reality that every person who is born begins to grow old, fall sick and die. This is the reality of life. And because we are not willing to accept that reality, we begin to cry and lament about this. Now the important thing is, we ask the question, is this true or is it false? And so this is why people try to find out the meaning of life. He was reading a book by also supposed to be a psychologist. He's writing about the meaning of life. So, but every meaning is some kind of way of thinking. So the question arises, what is the truth? And so, today we are mainly talking about truth. And to understand the truth, the first thing that happened in the history of philosophy is to make use of the human ability to think. Thinking and using our ability, which is called reasoning. What is it that we call reasoning? We are asking the question, what is the reason for this? That is what is called reasoning. What do you mean by reason? Reason means we are asking for the cause. So people begin to ask, if there is a belief that there is a God to protect us, we can ask, what is the reason for this? What is the reason for believing in God? So this questioning is called reasoning. So the first way to solve this problem, people began to use reason. And so that is what philosophers call rationalism. Rationalism means the use of reason. But the problem is, it is okay to use reason, but using reasoning, different people come to different opinions. The same kind of reasoning you use and you come to a different conclusion. So different people come with different conclusions using reason. So they couldn't come to an agreement. So what happened? These people who began to think began to realize that we cannot arrive at truth by reasoning. So one philosopher said, we cannot arrive at truth by reasoning. The only thing that we can call truth is what we can see with our eyes, or hear with our ears, or smell with our nose, or taste with our tongue, or touch with our body. So we have five senses: the eyes, the ears, the nose, the tongue, and the body. So whatever we perceive through the senses, only that is what we can call truth. This is how this thing called science began. Science is based on this. Just by using reasoning, if you come to a point, the scientist doesn't accept it. It has to be verified through experimental observation. So experimental observation is using the eyes or ears or nose or tongue and the body to touch. Unfortunately, one scientist comes up with something like Isaac Newton. He saw that when you throw a ball up, it comes down. Why does it come down? He thought it was due to a force called gravity. There was a force called gravity that attracts things. That's why you can't throw it up and it won't go up. So they thought the best thing is to understand that there is a force called gravity. Now that remained accepted by the other scientists for some time, and then came another scientist that we have heard of called Einstein. He pointed out there is no such thing as gravity. And he brought forward the theory called the theory of relativity. There is no gravity. So that means, even through experimental observation, you cannot arrive at the truth. So then people thought, in that case, what we experience through the senses is not the truth. The real truth is outside sensory experience. There must be something outside. So this philosopher called Immanuel Kant, he's the man who said there is no what we perceive through the senses is not the truth. The real truth is outside the sensory observation. We are not able to see the truth or hear the truth or smell the truth or taste the truth, but it is there outside. Because there must be something there for us to see. So he spoke of two things, what he called the phenomenon and the noumenon. What is outside that cannot be seen is the noumenon. What we see is the phenomenon. So people began to say the real truth is outside. And that truth was called the transcendental truth. The truth which is beyond experience. The transcendental truth. So there were other philosophers who thought about this. Like you may have heard of Bertrand Russell. This person said, we cannot accept that. Why? Because if you talk about a transcendental truth, you may have not seen that, but still, that is an idea in the mind. It is still inside you. What is outside the experience, you cannot know. So if you talk about something outside the experience, still it is an idea in your mind. So we cannot get out of this. So whatever we talk about is within our experience. It is not outside. So he began to say that whatever we call truth is an idea. And not only that, it is expressed in a language. And if it is expressed in a language, it is a statement. And a statement comes in the form of a sentence. So we can only talk about sentences, and we can analyze sentences to find out whether the sentence is a meaningful sentence or a meaningless sentence. If we talk about something that we have never seen or heard or smelled or tasted or touched, it is a meaningless statement. If we talk about something that we have seen or heard, then it is a meaningful statement. So we cannot talk about truth and falsehood. We can only talk about meaningful statements and meaningless statements. These are called the linguistic philosophers because they are talking about language. Another school of thought came up and said, all these philosophers are talking nonsense because they are trying to go after truth. There is no such thing as truth. And the purpose of human thinking is not to discover truth. The purpose of human thinking is to solve problems. So if a person can provide the solution to a problem, it can be verified. And if we can solve the problem using that method, then it can be accepted as a true solution. And that solution can be called a truth. Because it solves the problem. So it can be tested to find out whether it solves the problem. Now, if it solves the problem, it can be called truth. But the solution of the problem is also something that is good. Therefore, truth and goodness is the same thing. Truth is the same thing as good. So you see, so the philosophers came to that point. Then another school of philosophy came up and said, these philosophers are just trying to solve useless problems. There is only one basic problem that needs solution, which is the main problem in life. And that problem is that every human being is aware of one basic thing, that human being exists. Everyone thinks, I exist. That existence is the basic human experience. But at the same time, every human being is aware that he is going to die. Every human being that is born will die. And death is not only for old people, even young children die. So death is the sure thing. And that death, no one likes to die. When a child is born, people are happy. But when a person dies, they begin to cry and lament. You see, they don't realize that birth and death are the two ends of the same stick, which we call life. Life begins with birth and ends with death. And in between, what you get is what is called aging. From the time you are born, you are approaching death. And that is the aging process. This creates fears, worries, anxieties. That is the problem of life. And this is the only problem, the basic problem that needs to be solved. These people, these philosophers who brought up this problem, they were called existential philosophers, because their basic thing is the idea of existence. And with the idea of existence comes death and the worries and anxieties, fears that come up with that. And one existentialist was that man called Kierkegaard. He was a Christian. And he came to the conclusion that the human mind is not able to solve this problem. So the only solution is to take the leap of faith and pray to God to solve the problem. That was his solution. But there were other existentialists who didn't believe that. They said, we can't accept the idea of God. So the only thing is, the human being has to solve this problem. But no one was able to solve this problem. But it was the Buddha who really solved this problem. How did he solve the problem? Did he find the way of not dying? Because death is the problem. Did the Buddha die? Or did he not die? This is very important to understand that. No, I put it in very short. What the Buddha pointed out was, the mistake is done by the existential philosophers. What is the mistake? Because these philosophers think that they are existing. And the fact is that we are not existing. It is only when we have understood that we are not existing that the problem is solved. Existence itself is a delusion. It is only a dream. We are only dreaming that we exist. We have to awaken from this dream. It is only when we have awakened from this dream that we are existing. That we solve the problem of existence. Now, of course, to go into this further, we have to go into a long discussion. But we get back to the Kalama Sutra. Because in the Kalama Sutra, the Buddha is talking about this problem that modern philosophy has introduced. Because these people came and asked the Buddha, what is the truth? How do we get at the truth? Are we to believe what these people say? So the Buddha started by saying, it is correct to doubt. Because these people pointed out the philosophers were saying that philosophy begins with doubt. Here the Buddha says it is correct to doubt. And then he says, don't go by your traditional beliefs. Don't accept what other people tell you. Don't go by what is in the religious books. Don't accept. Don't accept even if it is based on logic and reason. Even rationalism is thrown out. Then he points out, don't believe it because the philosophers who thought that what is perceived through the senses is the truth, that kind of philosophy was called empiricism. So here the Buddha points out, don't accept, even because you have seen or heard or smelt or tasted or touched. That is, given up empiricism. And then he says, don't accept it because there are some people who say, I can see through my extrasensory perception. Going beyond the senses, I can see through some special psychic powers, I can see the truth. The Buddha says, don't accept that. Because even that is what is called transcendental truth or transcendentalism. That is also rejected by the Buddha. Then he says, even if you have faith in your teacher, don't accept just because your teacher said so. So in other words, he is rejecting all these truths. And then, of course, he says, when you know for yourself that a certain thing is good, or certain thing is the wise thing to do, or when a certain thing is done, it has happiness coming from that. Then go by that. But here, There is something very important here. When the Buddha said that, there was this psychologist called Sigmund Freud. He pointed out that there are three parts of the mind. What he called the id, the ego, and the superego. The id is going after pleasure. That is a part of the mind that is always seeking pleasure and avoiding pain. Seeking pleasure and avoiding pain. That is what he called the id. There is another part of the mind that is guided by logical thinking, reasoning. That is what he called the ego. Ego is thinking in terms of logic and reasoning. And there is another part of the mind that is always trying to be good and trying to avoid bad. That is what he called the superego. You see, now here, when the Buddha says, when you know that a certain thing is good, so that means there the Buddha is talking about using the superego. Because the superego is always trying to find out whether it's good or bad. When you know that when a certain thing is the wise thing to do, that is what the ego is looking for. The ego is always thinking that this is the wise thing to do. This is using logic and reasoning. And then, there is this other part that is trying to find out whether it is bringing pleasure or bringing pain. That is the what is called the id. So here the Buddha is using these three parts really. Here the Buddha, now the question arises whether the Buddha ever speak about the id, ego and superego. The Buddha has been speaking about this, but he never used those words, id, ego and superego, but he used other words. There is a word called upadana that the Buddha used. Upadana. And he spoke of four upadanas. That four upadanas is kama upadana, ditti upadana, silabbata upadana, and attavada upadana. Four upadanas. the kama upadana that he spoke of is really, now I have to of course go into this meaning of the words that I used. Upadana really means upa-adana. Upa means inside. Upper means outside. So upa-adana means, adana means to take. Now we have the word adinnadana. Adinnadana means to take what is not given. Adinna means what is not given. Adana means to take. To take what is not given. That is what is called either robbing or stealing. You see, upa-adana. So you are taking in, that is the meaning of upa-adana. Upa means inside. Adana means to take. Taking what is inside or taking in. The real meaning of taking in is to make something mine. This is mine. Now if I take this cup and say this is mine, that is upadana. Now, in this upadana, we are taking in things, which is, I use the word, personalize. You know what personalize means. Now, if you go out to buy a pen, that person who sells you the pen might say, do you like your pen personalized? What does that mean? That they will engrave your name on the pen. So personalized means ownership, that you own the pen. If your name is personalized, that means you have owned the pen. That ownership is personalized. That is to own something. So upadana really means, some people translate like clinging or grasping, but it is not just clinging or grasping, it is more than that, is to say, this is mine. You see, and there are four things that we personalize. One is, if I have a desire for something, that desire is personalized. This desire is mine. Or if I hate something, it is, this hatred is mine. So we personalize our desires or hatreds. That is personalizing our emotions, really. And then ditti upadana means to personalize our ideas, our views. We personalize our views. Then we also personalize our sense of right and wrong, good and bad. That is personalizing the kamupadana, dittupadana, silabbata upadana. Silabbata. Sila means to avoid doing bad is what is called sila. Now, in the five precepts, if you observe the five precepts properly, that is called sila. That is, you are avoiding bad behavior. So sila is to avoid the bad things. And bata is to be doing the good things. So you do two things. One is you avoid the bad things and you begin to do the good things. And before you do that, you have in your mind the idea of what is good and what is bad. That is the silabbata upada. So in other words, those three things, the personalizing the emotions or the desires and the hatreds, that is what Freud called the what are those words that I used? The the three words are the
ego. Huh? Ego and superego.
Yeah.
The ego and the superego.
Yeah. It, ego and superego. That's right. The it is the Kamupadana. Kamupadana is the id. And yeah, the id. The ego is the ditti upadana. And the superego is the silabbata upadana. So this is very important to understand. But there was a fourth one that the Buddha spoke of, and that is what is called attavada upadana. That is the personality perspective. That means we are thinking of a self. Now, this is going too much into Freudian psychology, but is good to know it. The important thing is that what Freud thought was these three things are going against one another. So when the mind is properly normal, these don't come in conflict. So he thought these are three parts of the mind, which is the three parts of the self. And they are all three parts of the self, and the three parts must be united instead of one going against the other. But what the Buddha pointed out was these three parts are not parts of the self, because there is no such thing as self. So you have to give up these three things. It is only by giving up these three things that the conflict is resolved. So this is why although the Buddha's, the question was about what is truth, but here the Buddha pointed out that this is not even a philosophical problem, this is really a psychological problem. So from philosophy, the Buddha brought the people into psychology and also connected with ethics, the idea of good and bad. So this is, of course, a long thing to explain this properly. I only explained it in a very short way. So the important thing is that ultimately the real teaching of the Buddha is that he's not talking about a truth. There is no truth in the world. There are only views in the world. Now there is another sutra which is similar to this Kalama Sutra. This is, in this sutra, again another group of people ask the same question from the Buddha. But there the Buddha answers in a different way. He says, Ekaṁ hi satchaṁ na duttiya matti yasmiṁ phajāno vivade phajānaṁ. Now, here what the Buddha is trying to say is, if there is only one truth in the world and there is no second truth, there will be no conflict between people if there is only one truth. But different people think in different ways and they bring out different ideas as truth. This is why there is so much conflict in the world. Then he says, Naheva satchani bahuni nana anyatra sanyani chani loke takkancha ditti supakappetva satchang musati dvaya dhamma mahu. What this means is, there are no many truths in the world. There is only what is called sanya. Sanya means what you perceive through the senses. That is all that you have. But people begin to use these perceptions and build views using logic, and by doing so they talk about two things called truth and falsehood, and there is no such thing as a truth and falsehood. We can only talk about what we perceive through the senses. That's what he's saying. So the only thing is, instead of talking about truth and falsehood, we can only talk about problems and solutions. That is what, and that problem is what the Buddha called dukkha. And the solution to this problem is what he called what is today called the Noble Eightfold Path. So he gives a solution to the problem, and that solution is what I call a paradigm shift. This is a very interesting word, paradigm shift. That means a paradigm is how we see the world, how we think of the world and how we think of ourselves. And that way of thinking is producing this problem. And so the Buddha's method of solving the problem is to start thinking in a different way. So these two ways of thinking is, one way is what is called existential thinking. These existential philosophers were thinking of a thing called existence. What we really have is what is called experience. Now, experience means when we see something, seeing is an experience. Hearing is an experience. Smelling is an experience. Tasting is an experience. Touching is an experience. When we experience, there are two parts we create. The two parts are called the subjective and the objective. You see, when I see this cup, one, the cup is an object that I see. But there is also what is called seeing. So there are two parts, the seeing and what is seen. The seeing is a subjective experience. What is seen is an object. It's an objective experience. The subjective experience I personalize and say, this is mine. The seeing is mine. The object is something outside. So that is called alienation. The subjective experience is personalized and the objective experience is alienated. So when these things are, one is personalized, the other is alienated, I am also creating these two as existing. The cup that I see is existing. And what is mine becomes myself. So I am existing and the cup exists. And when I exist and the cup exists, I am creating a relationship between myself and the cup. The relationship can come in the form of a desire, or it can come in the form of a hatred, or it can come in the form of a fear, or it can come in the form of a worry. That relationship is the suffering. So, the moment the existence comes into being, the relationship occurs and the suffering comes into being. Now, if I look at it in a different way and see it simply as an experience only, seeing is an experience. I don't have to personalize the subjective or alienate the objective. If I look at it only as seeing, as an experience, there is no personality here. There is no existence here. And to change from existence to experience is to think in a different way. That is the paradigm shift. And it is by doing that paradigm shift that the problem is solved. Of course, this is not an easy thing to understand fully. But this is the awakening from the dream of existence. That awakening from the dream of existence is what the Buddha achieved. That is why he is called a Buddha. The word Buddha means one who is awakened. Normally people are sleeping. They are sleeping and dreaming that they are existing. So it is only when we have awakened from that dream and we realize that there is no existence. That existence is called bhava. And the freedom from existence is bhava nirodha. So this is why the Buddha says, bhava nirodho nibbana. So what is called nibbana is the freedom from existence. When we have become free of existence, all suffering comes to an end. So this is not an easy job to understand that fully. So at least we have understood it to some extent. That is what ultimately the Kalama Sutra is trying to point out.